Hello everyone, I am Priyanka Mitra, Assistant Professor, Department of CSE from Jaipur Engineering College and Research Center. In this video, we are going to deal with C++ programming lab objectives. So first of all, we begin with the objective one, that is understand the basics of C++ library, variables, data input, output. Through C++ programming lab, we are covering the objectives of RTU syllabus. Which is the part of second year, third sem. Now, before moving on to the objectives, let's begin with the vision and mission of the institute. The vision of the institute is to become a renowned center of outcome-based learning and work towards academic, professional, cultural, and social enrichment of the lives of individuals and communities. For our institute, we have four missions. The first mission is to focus on evaluation of learning outcomes and motivate students to inculcate research aptitude by project-based learning. The second mission is to identify, based on perform perception of Indian regional and global needs, areas of focus and provide platform to gain knowledge and solution. Third mission is to offer opportunities for interaction between academia and industry. And the fourth mission is to develop human potential to its fullest extent so that intellectually capable and imaginatively gifted leaders can emerge in a range of professions. Now we move on to the vision and mission of our CSE department. The vision of our department is to become a renowned center of excellence in computer science and engineering and make competent engineers and professionals with high ethical values prepared for lifelong learning. The mission of the institute is to impart outcome-based education for emerging technologies in the field of computer science and engineering. Second mission is to provide opportunities for interaction between academia and industry. The third mission is to provide platform for lifelong learning by accepting the change in technologies. And the fourth mission is to develop aptitude of fulfilling social responsibilities. Next, we begin with the introduction to the C++ lab and scope. C++ lab is actually the father of all languages today, and it is very efficient. That is why it is very important to learn. And we have different versions every year, which are providing excellent flexibility, and the new versions are having more depths. Moreover, the new Python interpreter and the JVM, that is Java Virtual Machine, is also written in C++. This course, or we can say this lab, will develop the knowledge of C++ programming and basic data structures. Along with the C++ programming, we are able to study, we are going to be more familiarized with OOPS concept. Now the course outcomes of this lab is, we have two course outcomes. The first one is to understand and articulate the object-oriented approach for developing software programs using C++. And the second objective is to analyze and develop programs for reuse and maintainability to solve real-life problems using C++. So in this video, we are covering the course outcome one. Now, the basic definition of OOP and its features are that object-oriented programming language is a language, or it, we can say it follows an object-oriented programming paradigm that provides a way of modularizing the programs by creating partition memory area for both data and functions that can be used as templates for creating copies of such modules on demands. And the main feature is that we are focusing more on the doing part rather than procedures. And we have the programs divided into objects. The data structures are designed so that they characterize the objects. Moreover, the functions that operate on the data of an object are tied together in a data structure. We have the data abstraction property. That's why the data is hidden and can't be accessed by external function. Then we have the message passing functionality so that the objects may communicate with each other through functions. Now new data and functions can be easily added, and this proves us the property of inheritance, and moreover it follows the bottom-up approach in program design. Now after the introduction part, let's begin with our first objective to understand the basics of C++ library, variables, data and input output. Now C++ comes with libraries which provides us with many ways for performing input and output. In C++, input and output is performed in the form of a sequence of bytes, or more commonly known as streams. If bytes flow from a device like a keyboard, a disk drive or a network connection, etc. to main memory, then this is called input operation. And if bytes from main memory to a device like a display screen, a printer, a disk driver, or a network connection, then this is called the output operation. Now begin with our input output library header files. So these are the three header files which are important to C++, that is the iostream, the iomanip and the fstream. Iostream is this file defines the cin, cout, cair and clog objects which corresponds to the standard input stream, the standard output stream, the unbuffered standard error stream and the buffered standard error stream respectively. The second is the iomanip. This file basically declares services used for performing formatted input output with so-called parameterized stream manipulators such as setw and setprecision. Iomanip stands for input output manipulators. These methods declared in these files are used for manipulating streams. Fstream, this file declares services for user controlled file processing. This header file mainly describes the file stream. This header file is used to handle the data being read from a file as input or data being written into the file as output. Now we move on to a slightly more elaborated description of iostream. The first one is the standard output stream. This is a predefined object. Cout is an instance of ostream class. The cout object is said to be connected to the standard output device, which usually is the display screen. The second one is the cin, the standard input stream. The predefined object cin is an instance of iStream class. The cin object is said to be attached to the standard input device, which usually is the keyboard. Now the standard error stream, we can also say that it is unbuffered standard error stream. The predefined object cError is an instance of OStream class. The cer object is said to be attached to the standard error device, which is also a display screen, but the object cer is unbuffered. C++ cer is the standard error system which is used to output the errors. Now the next is the standard log stream, which is buffered standard error stream. The predefined object clog is an instance of OStream class. The clog object is said to be attached to the standard error device, which is also a display screen, but the object clog is buffered. It is an instance of iostream class and used to display errors, but unlike cer, the error is first inserted into a buffer and is stored in the buffer until it is not fully filled. Now we come up with our second iomanip. In this iomanip, iostream memory provides possibilities for input and output format. The first one is setBase, intBase. This is the function that setBase for the numbers output. The base can be octal, decimal and hexadecimal. The setw int n function used to set the width of the output. The parameter is fields width. Now setfill char type c function is used to set a fill character, and the setprecision int n which sets decimal precision for output of floating point values. Parameter n is the value of decimal precision. Now we come up with the fstream. Fstream is a subclass of iostream for bidirectional input output. You need to include both iostream and fstream headers in your program for file input output. To write to a file, you construct a ofstream object connecting to the output file and use the ostream functions such as stream insertion operator, put and write. Similarly, to read from an input file, construct an ifstream object connecting to the input file and use the iStream functions such as extraction, get, getLine and read. So these are the basics to understand the basics of C++ library. Now let's begin with our programming part. Now let's begin with our first program, that is the basic program Hello World. So our first program is to print a Hello World message. Now we have discussed the library, that is iostream. The hash include iostream is that library function. It is a declaration of library actually. Now the using namespace std, it means we use a namespace named std. Std is an abbreviation for standard, that means we use all the things within standard namespace. If we don't want to use this line of code, we can use the things in this namespace like this std cout std double colon endl. If this namespace is not used, then computer finds for the cout, cin and endl etc. computer cannot identify those and therefore it throws error. So it is essential to write the using namespace standard. Now then we have the main function in which its return type is int. That's why we have to write the return 0. Now this is cout hello world. So when we run this program, it simply print hello world. This is clearly displaying the message hello world. We are here using code blocks as a compiler. You can use other compilers also like Dev C++, or you can use like Turbo C on virtual machine also. Now we come up with our second experiment, that is write a program to calculate the average of two numbers. We are dealing with the C++ basic programs as a part of our first objective. Now in that to calculate the average of two numbers, we have our header file hash include iostream, which I have already discussed. Then we have the using namespace standard, which is very essential to write. Now int main, which is where this main function is the function where the compiler begin its execution. Float, this is the data type, the predefined data type. We have taken four variables, n1, n2, sum and average, as we need to calculate the average of two numbers. So we need as an input the two numbers n1 and n2. So to display on the screen, we use cout, which is the object, again cin, which is again the object of iostream class. Now enter the two numbers. When we when this is written in the screen, then we input the n1 and n2 values. Then it automatically computes the sum of n1 and n2 and display and also calculate the average. And finally, we display the sum and the average of the two numbers. So let's compute, or we can say that let's compile. Now we are going to enter the two numbers. Suppose we are entering 5 and 8. Now it is clearly showing the sum is 13 and the average is 6.5. Now we move on to our third experiment. These are basic programs, simple programs, just to learn how C++ and C are similar. Instead of writing the print statement, here we are using cout as a part of C++. In C, we are generally using the printf statement. And for scanning, we are using the scanf statement in C, but in C++, we are using the cin statement. So this is a program to calculate the factorial of a number, hash include iostream, which is again the header file, the namespace std, the namespace. This is the main program where the compiler starts its execution. Now as a part of a program, we have taken three integer type of variables, n, I and f. We have initialized the value of f equal to 1. Now cout is the print of the statement, enter the number. When we print enter number, so we have to enter the number which is taken as an input through cin, or we can say which the value through the keyboard is scanned. Now if the value entered is n equal to 0, then the factorial is computed as 0. But if we enter some other number, then till that iteration, it works and it computes the factorial of a number. From 1 to n, suppose I have written the number 5, then it computes this iteration loop, will work till 5, and then it computes the factorial, and we are printing the value of f with the help of this cout. Now let's compile this program. Now as a part of a program, we are entering the value 5, and the iterator works for 5 times and it is computing the value of 120. Now we move on to other fourth program, that is the program to calculate the maximum of two numbers. Again we have the iostream, the header file, the namespace standard, the namespace. Now int main, here we have taken as an integer variable x and y. Enter two integers, cin scanning the two values x and y. Now we are going to calculate the maximum value by using a function. So max is our function. Now max is a function which is having a return type of int, and as a part of parameter we have input the a and b, the two numbers. So the input which we have entered in cin, that is the x and y, we have taken as an input int a comma int b. Now as a part of program, or we can say that as a part of max function, we are calculating if a is greater than b, then return a as the maximum value, else return b as the maximum value. So once we enter the inputs, it is returned here where the function is called, and after the maximum equal to max, the number is printed. It is very essential to write return 0 because we have written the main function return type as int. In some compilers, they take it as a void. So in case of void, there is no need to write the return 0 statement. Now we run this program. Enter the two integers. Now let's write 45 and 80. Now it is calculating the maximum value is 80. So we have defined the simple basic functions as in C, similar to, they are also very similar in C++. Now again our next program, the last program of this lab, that is write a program to swap the integer value. So we are not using any function or a pointer concept here to swap the two integer values, but we have write our code within the main function. So again we have the IO stream, the namespace, standard, main function from where the compiler starts its execution, the float values n1 and n2, and s is the, we can say, a temporary variable. So cout enter number 1 and number 2. When we input the value, then this value is scanned, then we use s as a temporary variable and we store the value of n1 in s, then the value of n1 is replaced by the value of n2. And then the value of n2 is replaced by the value of that temporary variable s. So after doing this, we are getting the swapped values of a and b. So let's compile this statement. Suppose we have entered the value 5 and 9. Now the swap values are 9 and 5. So that's all for today. Thank you.